Hello, everybody, and welcome to this special edition of the program. I'm Fred Pleitgen, in for Christian Amanpour, coming to you tonight from Munich in Germany. There's been some progress recently in the fight against ISIS, with Kurdish forces making headway in northern Iraq. However, ISIS remains entrenched, both in Iraq as well as in Syria, and very little is known about its inner workings and also how high morale is among its fighters. Now, the German author Jürgen Todenhöfer has managed to get access to ISIS both in Iraq and in Syria. He's a former German politician who now travels the world trying to understand the conflicts of our times. Tonight, for the first time, you're going to be able to listen to the interviews he conducted and see the video he filmed. Jürgen Todenhöfer, welcome to the program. Thank you for joining us.
Hi.
ISIS is an organization that a lot of people obviously hate, a lot of people fear, but very few people know anything about. Their leader, Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi, has only been seen once in a mosque in Mosul. You were there as well. What was it like when you went there?
It was a little mosque, and I got a lot of trouble because I wasn't allowed to enter. And I've been criticized, and we had a hard dispute about that. I wasn't allowed to go there because I was only a Christian.
What's life like under ISIS? What's life like for the people in Mosul? Because that was the main place that you visited.
Life seems to be normal. I say seems. Normal like life is in totalitarian countries under dictatorships. But if you say seems to be normal, it means that you have to know that 130,000 Christians have been forced to leave, that an incredible number of Shias have been forced to leave and have been killed, that the Yazidis have been killed, and that only the Sunnis are still in this city. So I think after 1 week you cannot say how life really is. I've been in Mosul 11 years ago, but I must say, because I have to tell you the truth, it looked like 11 years ago. Without this plurality with Christians and Shias, which was also the charm of this city.
One of the things that people there seem to at least appreciate about this totalitarian leadership that you're talking about there is that the police force seems to work, is that daily life seems to work. Is that the impression that you got? How are things organized? Is the Islamic State, as it calls itself, building state institutions there?
It works like many states in this area, especially in the field of law and order, of course, but this is very important for these people who have been discriminated by a Shia government, which was discriminating and killing also the Shia, the Sunni population. And for many Sunnis, I think many Sunnis, moderate Sunnis, don't like the radical IS Sunnis, but they prefer them to the Shia government they had before. So they had a choice to make, if they wanted to be discriminated by Shias or if they want to live with IS. And I have the impression that there is no resistance against IS in the Sunni population. And I know the Sunni population very well because I've spent in 2007 during the war against the United States a lot of time with these moderate Sunnis, and they told me exactly the same.
The fighters seem to be very confident, they seem to be very proficient and very successful on the battlefield. And we're going to take a look at an interview that you did with an ISIS fighter in Mosul.
It took you how many days to conquer Mosul?
About 4 days. We did not kill all 24 of them. We killed a fewer number, but they got terrified and ran away. We did not retreat. God has promised us victory. We must fight.
And you think that you will win the war all over Iraq and Syria? Are you sure?
We are certain that God will bring us victory and that all countries will be conquered. We will get to Rome, Istanbul, and even the United States. We are certain of that.
On TV, we see beheadings. We see people being enslaved. How much of that did you see when you were there?
I didn't see that, but this is horrible for me too. I saw these videos too. But these beheading videos are a part of the strategy of IS to make fear and terror in the field of the enemies. And that is, this is one of the reasons why the enemies run away when the fighters of IS arrive. It's a clear strategy. And I had every day long discussions with them because I said, you know, I have read the Quran. I know Islam. Islam is a religion of mercy. But where is your mercy? And they answered, there's no time for mercy now. We prefer that our enemies fear us.
Why wouldn't the local population rise up against that, though? How can they live under something like that?
The Sunni
population... They're not radical. The Sunnis of Iraq are not radical people.
Yeah, but the Sunnis of Mosul and the Sunnis of the province of Anbar are moderate, but they have nothing to fear from IS. They accept IS, and IS is helping them, is providing food and things for the poor people of Mosul. So that's not the problem. IS is a huge problem for all the other religions, for Shias. And this is, for me, there are the two points which were very, very hard to understand for me. The first point was this incredible enthusiasm of these fighters. And this huge amount of young people who arrive every day, 50, 100, 150, from the United States, from all over the world, even from New Jersey. You know,
You met people from New Jersey. You saw people from New Jersey.
You don't suppose a young boy from New Jersey fighting for IS. I met the last fighter I spoke to was a guy from an island near the United States. I don't want to mention it because I don't want to make problems for his family. He just passed his law exam with a brilliant mark, and he just got a great job offer, and he refused this job offer because he wanted to fight for the Islamic State. They believe that they do something great, something historical, something good.
They've also taken a lot of prisoners, of course, not just women, but also fighters. And we're going to look at an interview clip now that you did, because you were able to actually meet a prisoner of war as well.
What did they tell you? What will happen to you?
Our captors said that we have Islamic State fighters imprisoned with the Kurdish regional government. You are prisoners here, and we will trade you back for our fighters. They didn't say they will kill or slaughter.
What did you feel when you talked to that man?
I felt incredibly sad because he was so weak. He said, I'm so grateful that you speak to me. And then I realized that hundreds of people were arriving to watch this situation, and I stopped the conversation. This man was completely broken and very sad situation.
I mean, it's very possible that he was tortured and subjected to other sorts of abuses.
I don't know. I will not talk about things, I suppose. I think the only reason why he's not yet killed is because he could be exchanged against IS fighters.
The way that the West is trying to react to the Islamic State is a mix of a bombing campaign, arming moderate rebels, Syrian rebels, and also trying to get some sort of Sunni uprising going on in Iraq. Do you think that that has any chance of winning from what you see with the Islamic State? Why?
No. The first reason is why is because IS is powerful. They are very, very strong. You see, I don't like them, but they are strong. I had to admit that these people are strong. You saw this interview with a young fighter in Mosul. They were 400. They won the battle against 25,000 soldiers and militias. 400 or less than 400. These are very strong people. That's one reason why I'm pessimistic, and I think bombarding has been always the wrong strategy.
But you say they're strong. How can you win without bombing them?
How do you want to bomb them? They stay in Mosul. 5,000 fighters live in Mosul. Everybody in another house. They don't stick together. They don't travel in convoys. I traveled with them, but never in a convoy. There was a lorry between us, and the second car was far away. Nobody sticks together. They live in different houses, and they live in Mosul, a city with 3 million residents. And to kill 5,000 IS fighters, you would have to destroy the whole city and to kill hundreds of thousands of civilians. That's not a strategy, and it will not work. The only way to fight down IS is to fight them down with moderate Sunnis. Only the moderate Sunnis can win a battle against the radical IS. And they did it. In 2007, there was also an Islamic State in Iraq. And this Islamic State in Iraq, called ISI, was fought down by the moderate Sunnis. But at this time, the IS was not that strong.
But that was with the Americans telling the moderate Sunnis that they would get government jobs afterwards, they would be integrated into the Iraqi security forces. None of that happened. We're a lot further along.
They felt threatened, yeah. But it would be in a certain sense the same strategy. So I say the Western countries cannot fight down IS. Only Arabs can fight down IS, and only Sunni Arabs can fight IS. And the Sunnis will only fight against IS if they are reintegrated in the country of Iraq. They are completely discriminated. And this
one,
is...
One group that you're not talking about is the FSA right now, the moderate Syrian rebels.
They're laughing about the FSA. They don't take them for serious. They say the best arms seller we have are the FSA. If they get a good weapon, they sell it to us. And they didn't take them for serious. They take for serious Assad. They take for serious, of course, the bombs. But they fear nobody, and FSR doesn't play any role.
We're going to talk a lot more about ISIS's strategy, about their long-term goals. We'll have more from Jürgen Todenhofer, who's just visited the Islamic State, in just a moment.